that we can change our destiny. We can change the circumstances around our life. We don't have to tolerate, we don't have to accept, we don't have to put up with what the enemy has for our life, but we can do what God wants to do. And I just want to share some things this morning that I believe can set us free. I want to ask some questions first. Number one, let's wage war on pain, trouble, and sorrow.
Oh, how lovely.
Let's wage war on these things. I mean, let's not tolerate these things. Have you become convinced that your destiny is to suffer pain, sickness, and defeat? Is that how we feel? Are we convinced that nothing can change because you've suffered for so long? You see, sometimes we can suffer for so long. Things, you know, we try everything in the book. You go to the Benny Hinn meeting, you go to this one's meeting, you try this. You do all the things that you read in the Bible, and yet you're certainly not any better. And sometimes then when that happens to us, we're sort of in our mind, whether we're saying it, but in our mind we're convinced that this is my life. This is how it's going to end up for me. This is where I'm at. And so what I'm saying today is that I believe that we can wage war on that. Have you given up and resigned yourself to the position that there's nothing that can be done about your situation? So, you know, what I'm talking about is real issues that people face every day in life. And Christians face these things too, where we get so just bombarded by the enemy that we think that there's nothing more that can be done. There's no way out. Perhaps you were born in a negative environment. Perhaps you were born into a situation of negativity and failure all around you. Sometimes you can feel you're trapped. I know a lot of people that feel they're trapped. But good news for you today, you can change your destiny.
Yes.
You can change your destiny. Thousands of people who once thought there was no hope have come into the light of God's Word. The truth in God's Word, and have found that by daring to believe the Word of God, their whole destiny, their whole life can be totally changed, totally transformed. I want to read a story to you. It's found in 1 Chronicles chapter 4 and verse 9. And it says, "Now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, and his mother called his name Jabez, saying, 'Because I bore him in pain.' And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, 'Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain.' So God granted him what he requested." I want to just say this to start with. There's times that we can say something, and there's times that we can say something.
That's right.
There's times when we can say something, and there's times that we can say something.
Right.
I hope you can catch my drift here. Because sometimes we say something because we've been told to say something, or because we've read it in a book that says that we can say something. But there's another time when what we say becomes a revelation and an understanding, and you're not saying it just because it's a parrot thing, but you're saying it because you believe it and you understand it, and something's happened now that when you say it, it contacts something, it comes into contact with God, and something draws from heaven and comes down upon your life and changes your circumstance forever. See, a lot of times I've counseled with people and talked with people and asked them about things, and they said, I've done that. I've come to realize that there's a lot of things that I've done in my life. There's a lot of times that I've prayed and said things, but deep down in my heart, because of the trouble, because of the problem, because of the situation, because of even the hopelessness that gets around your life, you feel like that, but you're saying something, but you're not saying it out of faith. You're saying it out of what you think you're going to say. But I'm talking about when we get into faith, when we get into the things of God, and it comes out differently, and it comes out with power, and it connects with God. I honestly believe that that's what God wants us to do today. Jabez did what you can do. He changed his destiny. I believe there is a key to unlock the prison doors that will set people free. There are keys. He said, "I'll give you the keys to the kingdom." You see, His very name tells of the condition of his life, Jabez. Jabez really means sorrow, pain, trouble. Sorrow, pain, trouble. Names in the Bible really meant a lot. See, Jacob means deceiver. He meant deceiver. He was a deceiver. His name had to be changed to Israel, which means a prince. His name had to be changed. Abraham meant high father. His name had to be changed to Abraham, father of many nations. See, things can change. We don't have a lot of importance on names today. Moses' name meant drawn out. That was a reminder that his life was preserved when they drew him out of the water. And that, that's what it meant. Joshua meant savior. He was to save his people. Today, God gives us something. It says, I want you to remember. When you take this communion, I want you to remember what I've done for you. And though, with the name of Jesus, it contains something. It's very, very powerful today. There's something there that you and I can grab hold of. Jabez, his name again meant pain, sorrow, grief, trouble. I don't know about you, but I thank God today that I have a new name, amen? I thank God today that I have a whole new life. I thank God today that my old name, my old sorrow, pain is gone forever. That's in the realm of the Spirit, that's what's happened. I have a new name, a new life. It's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Today, everything that God has given me is mine. I'm a new creation. I'm a brand new man. Old things have passed away. All things become good. You. Like Jabez, you may be convinced that this is how you'll always be. And he was like that. I believe it. He had this thing, weakness, sickness, pain. He was limited. Jabez would hear every time somebody mentioned his name, it would be, hey, pain, come over here. Hey, trouble, come over here. Hey, misery, come over here. And that thing would have got inside him. Sorrow, come over here. Grief, come over here. So the word was in him all the time. We've got to be careful what we hear. You've got to be careful what you say about yourself. You may have had words spoken over your life. We need to break some things, I believe, over our life. You'll never make it. Anybody ever had that spoken over your life? You'll never ever succeed.
Yeah, I've had that.
You're like your father or you're like your mother, you're a loser. You're not as good as your brother or you're not as good as your sister. You'll never be as good as them. And these words, are very, very powerful and they somehow or other get inside you. They you're impregnated by that. And so when you try to do something, these words keep coming up, you'll never really make it. You'll never do it. You'll never be there. And really, Jabez was like that. What caused Jabez to change? What caused the change that came upon his life? How did this man change? It was their custom in those days that they went to the synagogue. They went to hear the preachers. And sometimes it can be our custom to go to church. People have got customs. We just go to church. And he would have gone to church most certainly every Sabbath. He would have gone Sabbath after Sabbath after Sabbath. He would have heard the prophets speak. He would have heard them sharing the word of God. He would have heard things. And sometimes we can come to church and we can hear a message and we can hear stuff. But I want to tell you, friends, there was one thing that changed that man's life. That this particular day, I believe that he went to church, he went with not necessarily a different attitude, but he went with an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. See, what will turn the tide, what will turn the tide for your life and my life is when you hear what God says about you. When you hear what God wants to say into your life, turning point, whatever it might be. You see, I believe that those words carry life. You'll never make it, you're no good. They're the words of the flesh, they're the accuser of the brethren. They're the words there that bring death to you. And there's only one way you're going to overcome that is when you hear the word of life. Because the word of life will penetrate deep on the inside. It will chew up, it will swallow up, it will just take away everything that the enemy has spoken over your life. I don't know about you, but I was brought up in a, I wasn't brought up in a Christian home. I was brought up in a home of alcohol and gambling and goodness knows what else. It was a strange home. It was a home that wasn't a happy home. My father was a baker, so you know I never saw him very much. When I did see him, he was usually drunk. When I saw him, he was angry. When I saw him, it wasn't good. I didn't like my dad. At the age of 17, I actually packed my dad's bags. I packed a suitcase for him. I don't know what I'll put in it now. But we have an old Willys truck. I threw it in the back of the truck. I took it from Townsville, where I lived, out to some railway station out of town, about 10, 15 mile, whatever it might have been. I pushed him out of the car. I gave him £5. That's all I had in my wallet. I gave him £5. I threw the suitcase at him and said, I never want to see you again.
Put on you.
But the thing is that's the sort of, I'm just wanting you to know, when I got married, that's what I brought into my marriage. I was saved, but our marriage went from wedlock to deadlock because I didn't understand. We needed something to change. I needed to hear some stuff. Nancy was an adopted girl. She needed to hear some things that would set her free from the bondages and the trouble and the hurts and the grief and the disappointment that was over her life. And you know, here's these two accidents looking for a place to happen, got married. Did we love each other? Yes, we loved each other with a passion. But that wasn't enough because of those things inside us. We needed to hear the Word of God, amen. And I think in March next year, it's 55 years, is that right? But this, what I'm saying is, we've got to hear the Word of God. The Word of God is so important. We need to have an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Otherwise, our minds and our emotions and everything else about us will take over. And this young man, you know, right in the middle of all the begots, it's in a strange place. This one begot this one. This one had the, and right in the middle is this, just these two little verses, which I think is so important because they hold a key that can unlock your life, unlock my life, take me to it. You know, I don't care whether you've been saved 100 years, there's still keys, there's still things that need to be unlocked in your life.
Exactly.
There's things there that if we're going to go to the next level, if we're going to go to the next place where God wants us to go, I believe it would have been his custom to go to the house of God. He would have been gone there for years and years and listened to all these preachers. But this day was a different day. He listened with a different ear. Friends, can we ask God, God, give me a different ear? Let me hear what the Spirit of God's saying. You know, we're just out there a little while ago, and Kimber was saying that he's out there in Cobar and out there in all the Mulga, and there's so many voices out there. There's so many doctrines. I was sharing this last Sunday. That there's so many voices out there. There's so many different opinions out there. There's some, this is right, that's right, this is wrong. But friend, we must have an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Otherwise, we're going to be tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, every bit of philosophy. Then, you know, I don't care how long you've been saved, we can all be affected by it. I believe if this is a day that I believe we're living in, the end times, I believe like never before, we need to have an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying, amen? Can we just lift up our hands right now and say, God, I need to have an ear to hear what you're saying, amen? Not what the accuser is saying, not what anybody else is saying. I want you to filter everything that I hear through this ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Fill it through that ear, my God. Fill it through love. Fill it through compassion. But my God, I want to hear what you have to say in Jesus' name. Amen. This young man would have gone today, this time, to hear a different preacher with a different attitude, but with a different ear. An ear to hear what the Spirit was saying. He was hearing what God had done to the children of Israel. The preacher could have been standing up there and saying, you know, here they were in bondage and they've been there for 400 years, but God moved by His Spirit and delivered them by His mighty hand. How they came out of that bondage, and there was not one weak or sick among them. You see, if you've got to hear some things like this, because you see, what the truth does is the truth penetrates. It penetrates like RP7. It penetrates right in beyond the rust, beyond the crud, the stuff that's built around our thinking, the hopelessness that gets around our lives. Friend, I'm not just talking to the four here. I'm talking to people because I know that at times hopelessness can get around our lives. Things can get around us that squeezes the very life out of us. There's only one thing, friend, that's going to bring more life. It's not a new husband. It's not a new wife. It's hearing what God says about it. Amen.
Right.
It's hearing what God's got to say about the situation. It's hearing what the Spirit is saying about it. And maybe he would have been hearing all these things about how God brought them out and through the wilderness where they got into hopelessness and there was no water. How God spoke and water gushed out of a rock. How there was no food there and God brought manna from heaven. How there that there was a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day that protected them. How God went before them and went with them and how God delivered them and how God did all these things. How they got hungry and they wanted meat and all of a sudden all around them was quail and they ate till they were full and choked on the stuff. He would have heard how God moved mightily, how God things, and then he would have gotten, right to a point where Jeremiah where it says, Ah, Lord God, thou hast... Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy right outstretched arm. And there's nothing too difficult for you. Nothing is too difficult. I can see it on what I meant. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thy great power and thy outstretched arm. Amen. And there's nothing too difficult for you. See, we've got to get that into our brain. There's nothing too difficult for you. There's nothing too difficult for God. I want to tell you, those things that attack your body, they are nothing to God. Amen. There's nothing too difficult for God. Those things that get around us, there's nothing too difficult for God. Until we get that into us and it's inside us, friend, I want to tell you, we will live a life far below where God wants us to live. I believe that this young man would have been hearing that, and then he would have heard, Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. And all of a sudden, something there, the Bible says, that Jabez called upon the name of the Lord. He cried out to his God. He said, God, will you deliver me? God, will you set me free? God, will you extend the borders of my tent? God, I don't want to be in pain. I don't want to be in misery. I want to be set free. And the Bible says that God granted him that which he requested. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power. Amen. And our great, I want to tell you, there's nothing too hard for God. There is nothing too hard for God. Can God save a city in a day? Yes, he can. Can God deliver people from arthritis? Yes, he can. Can God deliver you from your back condition? Yes, he can. I want to tell you, you've got to hear with a different ear. We've got to hear with an ear of the Spirit and hear what God's saying to us in Jesus' name. Amen. There was a man in the Bible there. He was full of hopelessness and negativity. He was on the backside of a desert. He had missed his chance. He was most really saying, what if? What if? You know, one of the things that we say today, what if? What if I would have married another woman? What if I would have married somebody that had a lot of money? What if? What if? Friend, those what ifs are stupid, amen?
That?
That was a good whistle. They're stupid, but friend, it's got nothing to do with what ifs. It's got everything to do with now. It's got everything to do with hearing what God says. It's got everything to do with crying out to God. Call unto me and I will answer thee. Can I say what I've tried before? No, you must have tried it differently. I've tried too. Yes, come on. But I'm trying again. Amen. God, I believe that you've called us. And here's this man in the backside of the desert, kicking jam tins, whatever he was doing. And all of a sudden there's a burning bush. And God spoke to him through that burning bush. He said, I missed my opportunity. I missed my chance. I'm old now. It's past my time. It's this, it's that. He says, no, it's not. This is the hour, amen. This is a turning point. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This This is a turning point. This is what I've ordained you for. This is what I've called you for. This is what I've drawn you for. Come on, I've drawn you out of the water. This is the moment. This is it. This is what I preserved you for right now. This is your hour. Rise up. And of course we know that he went in and he delivered the children of Israel. There's another man who was past his age. He was 100 years old. And there was no hope for him. He had no heir. He didn't have the one that he wanted. He had a child from a bondwoman, but he wanted an heir from his own body. He was promised an heir from his own body. And it looked hopeless, it looked negative. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power. There's nothing too difficult for you, amen. Call unto me and I will answer thee and show you great and mighty things which thou knowest not. I want those scriptures to be indelibly printed into our brain.
That's right.
They say you shouldn't get a tattoo. Well, get a tattoo on your brain. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heaven and the earth. God is real, amen. God is very, very real. And of course we know there that he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. He somehow or other, he heard with a different ear. He heard with what the Spirit was saying. Moses now hears what the Spirit is saying. Come on, rise up, go and get it. Come on, go and get it. Come on, Abraham, go in and take the land. Go and possess it. Do what I've asked you to do. There's an heir. He staggered not at the promise of God, nor that at his age being 100 years old, or the deadness of Sarah's womb. But somehow or other, he believed God. He believed and he started to call unto God. We know there that the Bible says that it was granted to him and it was accounted to him for righteousness. What an amazing statement that is. There's a whole preach in that. I want to tell you, friends, God is looking for a people, I believe, that will cry out to God. We just don't want to come to prayer meetings and just bang, dash our gums together. We want to start calling on God, amen. We want to cry out to God. Come on, God. Like the other Sunday, we got up here and we started to break some strongholds. We started to believe for a breakthrough. We're saying, come on, we're going to break this thing. We're going to smash this thing. Today, we've heard a turning point. Come on, let's speak turning point, amen. Let's say, come on, this is a turning point. This is God. This is what you're at. I was on an airplane. Nancy and I were on an airplane. And we were sitting up in this plane. And God said, would you go back to the Sunshine Coast and plant a church? There's unfinished business there. I want to tell you, friends, the devil will do everything he can to get you off course. But I want to tell you, hell will have to freeze over. We're hanging in here. We're sticking in here. We're believing we're going to see a new Spirit of God. God's going to raise up an army. God's going to raise up a people. Not because the devil said it, but I want to hear now. I don't want to hear the bumbling and the mumbling and the grumbling and the griping and the goodness knows what. I want to hear what the Spirit of God says. And I'm reminding myself today, what the Spirit of God says. He said, go and raise a church up. I'm going to plant something. I'm going to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you could imagine or think. I've got stuff inside of me that God has promised me that I have told nobody. But I'm hearing with a different ear. I want to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Amen. I want to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. I want to hear what the Word of God has got to say, amen. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things. I believe that there's a lot of people, if you're in this church, you've been mostly getting knocked about, bashed around, smashed, and goodness knows what. This is not just today, I believe it's in your life. But we're going to break some things, amen. We're going to bust some things. I remember speaking over you guys a couple of months ago, wherever it was, you were standing there. I just walked over and I said something about breaking something. And you came to me, she said, you won't believe it. Just a thing went. There's something about hearing the Word of God. Hearing with an ear to hear. Let us hear what the Spirit's got to say.
I think it's so powerful what Neil shared this morning. After being out west, we found there was a lot of voices and everything like that. Remember the story of the guy that was sitting in the temple. He had silver and gold have I none, said Peter and John. Now that guy would have sat there. Jesus would have passed by many times going to the temple. So would have Peter and John. And you think, why didn't Jesus touch the man when he went by there, or other times when Peter and John were going there? We can ask that question. But I want to tell you that that particular day, I believe that guy was sitting there, his spirit was open to hear something of the Spirit. And Peter said, silver and gold have I none, and people get carried away with the silver and gold, being a Christian, whatever. But he heard something in the Spirit. And when he heard that, he got up and walked, leaping and praising God. And I think we're in the day now, there are so many voices, there's so many things coming against the church with voices of saying, you know, this is wrong, that's wrong, and something else is not going right and ever, and I've been away for, you know, 6 weeks or 5 weeks or something. But I come back here and I sense in the Holy Ghost turning point. We need to be like the guy at the temple where Jesus walked past many times, but this particular time his heart was open to hear what the Spirit is saying. Because the Bible says, out of your innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. Amen, it's within us. But we've got to be open to hear the right voices. And I couldn't sit there any longer. Neil, what you're sharing this morning is so relevant for people today. God's people to hear what the Spirit is saying.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And if we hear, then we can go walking, leaping, and praising God. Amen.
Amen.
And we're going to see things turn around. Turn around in your life individually. Turn around in the church. Turn around the people of God. Because we're in the day where the Holy Ghost is speaking directly to our spirits. But we need to be open to hear what God is saying.
Yep.
Amen. Are you with me this morning?
Yep.
Hallelujah. I'm excited.
Yep.
I'm pumped. I'm just so excited because we're living in the day where the Holy Ghost is upon us, and he's moving upon you, and he's there, and you're hearing certain voices, but let's hear what the voice of the Spirit is saying. Amen. This is so powerful what Neil is sharing this morning. Amen. Love you, Neil.
Pleasure, love you. Love you, Tim. Good man. Let me just go over a couple of little things there. I just want to hit a couple of points. Jabez would have obviously gone to church most of his life. He would have heard many, many things, but he was hearing also pain come over here. He was hearing what God could do, he was hearing all those things, but pain, sorrow, misery, all those things were speaking louder than what the Spirit of God in his hearing was saying. And that was holding him bound. But as he went to this day, this particular day, when he had an ear to hear, and he began to hear something. You know, I know a lot of people that come to church many times, and all of a sudden, they might go to church 10 weeks, and all of a sudden, on the 11th week, they give their life to Christ. What changed? Nothing changed if they had an ear to hear what God was saying to them. And they got saved, it got changed. But see, here's Jabez. As he goes to church this day, and the preacher most likely under the unction, everybody say unction,
unction
of the Holy Ghost, preaching under the anointing, under the presence of God. And as he's preaching, he's telling about the children of Israel and saying all that God had done, all those sort of things that God had done. And then, you know, as he's, you know, Jeremiah, you know, great God who made the heavens and earth and who created everything. And nothing is too hard for him. The penny would have started to drop. What I'm wanting you to understand is that the Word of God, the true Word of God, the Bible says you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. And the truth of God's word began to penetrate, get in through that ear to hear, penetrate on the inside, and started to eat up all that negativity, all that hurt, all that disappointment, all that that was holding him down. And then you know, call unto me and I'll answer you. And all of a sudden, he would have just jumped to his feet and started yelling out, yes, God, heal me, deliver me, set me free. And God heard and answered his prayer. I know today that we're in this place. We need a breakthrough, amen? We need a turning point. We need to see something happen. We need to be able to dig in or whatever you want to do. But come on, if God's speaking to you this morning, if God's talking to you in your life, if there's something there that you say, I'm just going to do it again. I'm going to go again. I've heard something this morning that has touched something on the inside of me. I'm going to push through. I want a turning point in my life. I don't have to put up with, I don't have to tolerate, I don't have to accept anymore. You know, I've heard of alcoholic husbands that don't even go to church, that the wife has been in church and she's responded to an altar and she's gone home and her husband says, I've decided I'm giving up the grog. Amen? You believe that can happen?
Yes.
Something about responding, there's something about hearing, there's something about prayer, there's something about calling out to God, there's something there that you need to hear. By the way, my dad didn't come back 9 months later.
Oh, good.
Everybody's happy about that. My dad got born again at 86 years of age. He died at 87.
Oh, how wonderful.
He gave his life to Jesus. He was a short man. Should have been a jockey. One day, he walked out the front, Ruckins McKinley. He walked out the front, he looked up at me and he said, are you coming out? I said, yeah, I'm coming with you. Then I followed him out and he looked at me and said, what are you doing here? And Ruckins was going on and 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 on. And I thought, oh, he'll bolt in a minute. He's got a fuse about the 16th of an inch long. He'll leave, he'll bolt. And then Ruckin said something and I thought, oh, he won't do that. How stupid can you be? When somebody's had an ear to hear and they've heard something, all my negativity couldn't hurt him. He said, would you raise your hands? Dad won't do that. You have to know my dad to understand what I'm talking about. Put his hands in the air. And gave the sinner's prayer. He got born again. Amen? Don't underestimate. He went to church every conference. He only went because I used to put prawns on him. But one day he went with an ear to hear. And he gave his life to Christ. This could be the turning point for your life. It could change the direction that you're going. It could change the whole... It just takes one... Dad just looked at me and said, you going up there? Yeah. It took that one step. That one step. I believe Jabez took that one step. God, deliver me. God said, I don't know where you're at today, but we're just going to stand at our feet. And today, if you want to take that one step, I would say, I know most all of you today know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in your life. But if you want to take that one step that will change the direction, you want to take that one step that will bring you out of that whatever it is, that hopelessness, whatever it is around you, that sickness, that pain, that hurt, I don't know what it is. This is totally up to you now. I've done all I can do. Spirit of God's here to meet with you. And if you want to just step that one step, bring that turning point in your life, turn that thing around, find that freedom. Remember when Nancy got set free, totally set free from the thing that bound her life forever. Just a prophet just walked over and said, one cup, two words over her life. Set it gloriously free, amen. Jesus, I love you. I know you're mine. You want to take that step? Take that step. Do it now. 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 Now's the time to do it. Tomorrow might be too late. One step, that's all it takes. One step. One step. One step. One step in your destiny. You can change your destiny. One step. One step. One step. One step. One step. One step. One step.